إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: إن تتوبا إلى الله فقد صغت قلوبكما وإن تظاهرا عليه فإن الله هو مولاه وجبريل وصالح المؤمنين والملائكة بعد ذلك ظهير. وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم: من زار قبري وجبت له شفاعتي. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: من زارني بعد مماتي فكأنما زارني في حياتي، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. Honorable scholars, respected brothers, elders, mothers and sisters and listeners of Channel Islam, Allah Rabbul Izzat has referred to the galaxy of Anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam as the cream of his creation. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبَرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Allah says, indeed, in the incidents and in the tales of the Anbiya, there is great lessons for people of intelligence. In Surah An'am, Allah speaks about various prophets and then Allah concludes the discussion by saying, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهُ فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِي. These indeed are the guided servants of Allah and follow their guidance. In Surah Saffat, Allah says, وَإِنَّهُمْ عِنْدَنَا لَمِنَ الْمُصْطَفَيْنَ الْأَخْيَارِ. That the prophets are our beloved and chosen servants. أولئك الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين. They are the favored category. So really, without isolating the problem of the derogatory cartoons against the noble personality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let me rephrase and readdress this whole saga that has been continuing and say that it is with great sadness that we have to say, and only Allah can know what would be the fate of a nation who decide to mock any prophet, just not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who decide to mock any prophet. Every divine religion has agreed and there is consensus that the prophets are the noblest of Allah's creation, and what can be the doom and the fate of a nation who decides to mock at the beloveds of Allah? When Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam built the ark and people passed by and they scoffed at him, they mocked at him, they jeered at him, as the Quran says, وَكُلَّمَا مَرَّ عَلَيْهِ مَلَأٌ مِّن قَوْمِهِ سَخِرُوا مِنْ قَالَ إِن تَسْخَرُوا مِنَّا فَإِنَّا نَسْخَرُوا مِنْكُمْ كَمَا تَسْخَرُونَ. They laughed at him. They laughed at him. As Muslims, we take offense from derogatory remarks made against any prophet. We don't isolate it to the noble personality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If Sayyidina Isa, Musa, or any prophet is insulted, it is against our teachings. In fact, maybe it would be noteworthy to share with you, under the commentary of this ayah, وَعَصَىٰ آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَىٰ, where Allah speaks about the mistake of Adam alayhi salam that he ate from the forbidden tree. But Allah makes reference to this mistake in harsh words in this verse. Allah uses two words, asa and ghawa. These two words are commonly translated as disobedience and deviation. Asa and ghawa are stern words. But under the commentary of this ayah in Al-Bahrul Muhit, there is a very, very beautiful quotation which makes us understand the stance that Muslims hold when it comes to the mistakes of prophets. Just so that we put into perspective our approach towards prophets. The author writes, لَا يَجُوزُ لِأَحَدِنَا الْيَوْمِ أَن يُخْبِرَ بِذَلِكَ أَنْ عَادَمِ إِلَّا إِذَا ذَكَرْنَاهُ فِي أَثْنَاءِ قَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى أَوْ قَوْلِ نَبِيِّهِ. we cannot refer to Adam alayhi salam as a sinner, as a transgressor, because he ate from the forbidden tree. Until and unless we are speaking of the text of Allah and the text of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we restrict ourselves exclusively, precisely to the text of Quran and Hadith. Furthermore, he writes, فَأَمَّا أَن يَبْتَدِئَ مِنْ قِبَلِ نَفْسِهِ فَلَيْسَ بِجَائِزٍ لَنَا فِي آبَائِنَا الْأَوَّلِينَ فَكَيْفَ فِي أَبِينَا الْأَقْدَمِ الْأَعْظَمِ الْأَكْرَمِ النَّبِيِّ الَّذِي تَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَغَفَرَ لَهُ. It is not correct of us, it is not becoming of us, it is immoral, unethical, that we make derogatory reference to our forefathers, to anyone in our ancestry. If we speak ill of them, that is unbecoming and it's not permissible. How can it be correct for us to make derogatory remarks of the first of human, the first of Nabi, the beloved servant of Allah, Adam alayhi salatu wassalam? So as Muslims, we hold in respect every Nabi. And we also believe that just as derogatory remarks to a Nabi is insulting, elevating him beyond his position is also insulting him. We also believe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tarfa'uni fawqa qadri." Listen, respect me according to the merit Allah has given me, and do not give me the powers of Allah. And hence you say regarding me what people said regarding Isa. Imam Ghazali has written a very brilliant thing. Subhanallah. May Allah give him jazai khair. He has written that it is our belief that prophets are divinely protected from sin and vice. However, they are not exempted from human mistakes. So a prophet will forget. It is human and they are not exempted from human mistakes. And he writes the wisdom why they are not exempted from human mistakes. He says, because of the many miracles they perform, there was the likelihood that people attribute the qualities of Allah to them. So Allah made it on a disguised note that they commit the errors of human that people understand. While they are the noblest of creation, they are still humans. It is only Allah's being that is flawless. وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا لَا يَظِلُّ رَبِّي وَلَا يَنْسَى. Those are the exclusive traits and qualities of Allah. But a prophet is bound to make a human error. So it is with great pain. Can we imagine what has happened to this world? The world has plunged so deep. At what levels of morals have we dropped? We are not isolating it to a Muslim problem. Let me repeat this here. We take offense to the cartoons against Jesus, peace be upon him. We take offense to the cartoons against Moses, peace be upon him. Alayhi salatu min Allahi wa taslimat. I think despite our difference of religion, we are on agreement that these were divine personalities. And then to add salt to injury and to make those comments against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I was reading one kitab, Allama Abdul Rauf rahimahumullah writes very, very brilliantly. He says, amongst the many specialities that Allah favored the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one is that Allah made reference to him in the Quran. Allah spoke about him. Allah mentioned his name. But then he made a critical analysis of the Quran. And he went down into one verse. And he did a deep study of the Quran. And he said, Allah has just not mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but Allah has made emphatic mention of every organ and limb of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran. So, I quote before you and you follow with me, the Huffaz will enjoy what I'm saying. قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. Allah speaks about the beloved face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Exclusive word, وَجْهٌ. Now what was this verse? Briefly, I will run you through the relevant incidents of each limb of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A person's name comes in the paper, in the newspaper, or maybe his shop came on record and he tells you, buy the star. You must buy this here. Just look at this section. And it gives him a sense of pride and recognition. And perhaps it gives him some form of authority. Allah has spoken of every limb of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he came to Madinah Munawwara and he faced Baytul Muqaddas for 16 to 17 months as Allah had commanded him, But obviously the heart, the inherent love of the Kaaba was inborn, because that was the Kaaba of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam as well. So occasionally he would glance to the heavens in the anticipation of revelation that he can face the Kaaba. So Allah said, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you know, one is you and I are waiting for our beloved. We're waiting for our left club. Imagine the Prophet of Allah is looking to the heavens waiting for Jibreel. You know, how can you explain that in words? I'm peeping from the window, I'm looking at my phone, I'm checking my email. I'm waiting for contact. The Prophet of Allah's contact sallallahu alayhi wasallam is with Jibreel. قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجِهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we were observing your repeated glance to the heavens. فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا. You have it. We now turn you to the Kaaba you want. We satisfy your desire. And say to your ummah there onwards, وَحَيْثُمَا كُنْتُمْ وَحَيْثُمَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرًا. Say to them, wherever they are, they will also face this Kaaba. So in this verse, Allah speaks of His beloved face. Jabir radiallahu anhu says, I stood outside and it was a bright moonlit night. I looked at the moon and the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam simultaneously. I swear by Allah, his face was brighter. Jabir radiallahu anhu says, I looked at the moon and I looked at the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam simultaneously. I swear by Allah, his face was brighter. But that's not all. Allah did not end on discussing or describing his face. Allah then spoke of the eyes on that face. Allah then spoke of the tongue in the Quran. So Allah made reference of his eyes. وَلَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ وَلَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ إِلَى مَا مَتَّعْنَا بِهِ أَزْوَاجًا مِّنْهُمْ زَهْرَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not stretch your blessed eyes. Do not stretch an envious gaze towards the glitter and the glamour what we have given to the disbelievers. One is the Shama'il al-Tirmidhi, which will explore the physical eye of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how it was shaped, how it was positioned, how beautiful it was. Then Sahaba will explain the nature of his gaze. There's been no human whose life has been preserved to the most minutest detail like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And let me add by saying, this again was the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Scholars say that if he had to hide any verse of the Quran, there's no person when he writes his biography, he ideally omits his mistakes and he speaks about the bright moments in his life. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that Nabi of Allah who conveyed to us every verse. He equally conveyed to us where Allah praised him, and he equally conveyed to us where Allah admonished him. So he held back nothing. He conveyed the verses where Allah disciplined him and Allah said, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّا أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. If it was us and we have to write our biography or convey our own message, we'll ideally omit the mistakes of our life. But he conveyed everything and Allah preserved every aspect of his life. So Allah told him, don't stretch your blessed eyes to the glitter of this world. Then he conveyed that very meaning to us in his hadith, and he said, مَنْ مَدَّ عَيْنَيْهِ, the riwayat of Targhib, مَنْ مَدَّ عَيْنَيْهِ إِلَى زِينَةِ الْمُتْرَفِينَ كَانَ مَهِينًا فِي مَلَكُوتِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَنْ صَبَرَ عَلَى الْقُوتِ الشَّدِيدِ صَبْرًا جَمِيلًا أَسْكَنَهُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْفِرْدَوْسِ حَيْثُ شَاءَ. The one who will stretch an envious eye to the wealth and the glitter and the glamour of any person, he will instantly collapse in the esteem of Allah. وَمَنْ صَبَرَ عَلَى الْقُوتِ الشَّدِيدِ صَبْرًا جَمِيلًا. And whoever will persevere patiently, Allah says, you will decide your own abode in Jannah. I will not designate it for you, you will decide it. Then Allah spoke of His tongue in the Quran. فَإِنَّمَا يَسَّرْنَاهُ بِلِسَانِكَ فَإِنَّمَا يَسَّرْنَاهُ بِلِسَانِكَ. O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have simplified the Quran on your blessed tongue. O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have simplified. And then how Allah did it for him. When the Quran was revealed and Jibreel would come to him, he would listen and he would read so that he could commit it to his memory. So then Allah said, we will exempt you from the task of memorizing. So Allah revealed the verse, Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. We will read it to you. Sanuqri'uka fala tansa. Don't hasten. So there was no task in memorizing. It was read and it was inserted in his memory. You know, you have a SIM card today and you insert it. Allah inserted the Quran, if I may use that metaphor. سَنُقْرِئُكَ فَلَا تَنْسَى إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ. You will not forget. Yes, those verses we intend to abrogate, we will cancel from your memory. So there were verses that were revealed, Allah abrogated it, and accordingly Allah erased it from his memory. فَإِنَّمَا يَسَّرْنَاهُ بِلِسَانِكَ. Allah speaks about the blessed face. Then Allah speaks about the neck of the Prophet ﷺ. What happened? The Prophet ﷺ was sitting. One young man comes to him. Ibn Mas'ud makes mention, the riwayat is in Baghawi. He comes and he says, O Prophet of Allah ﷺ, my mother wants your blessed garment. The Prophet ﷺ says, I only own one. The day I have another one, I will give you this one. I only own one. The day I have another one, I will give you. He returns, he comes back, he says, O Prophet of Allah ﷺ, I understand you don't have, but my mother has a passion, she wants the very one you're wearing. The very one you are wearing. The Prophet ﷺ was a very, very bashful human. He could not say no. No was not part of his vocabulary. Like how unfortunately, yes is not part of our vocabulary. Yes is not part of our vocabulary. No was not. مَا قَالَ لَا قَدْتُ إِلَّا فِي تَشَهُدِهِ مَا قَالَ لَا قَدْتُ إِلَّا فِي تَشَهُدِهِ. The poet says he never said no with the exception of once, and that is in tashahud when he negated and he said there's no God. That's the only time he said no. That's the only time he said no. And he said if it wasn't for tashahud, even here it wouldn't have been la, it would have been nam. But yeah, obviously this negation is desired. So the Prophet ﷺ goes in his room, removes his blessed garment, and he gives it to this young boy. Bilal radiallahu anhu, comes the time of salah, he has nothing to wear. He says, O Prophet of Allah, it's the time of salah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet ﷺ says, this is my condition. Some clothes were brought, he was given, he was clad. Allah then revealed the verse. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ عُنُقِكَ وَلَا تَبْسُطْهَا وَلَا تَبَسُطَهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْسُورًا. Allah said, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not tie your hand, your blessed hand, to your blessed neck. So mention of two organs, which Allama Abdul Ra'uf rahmatullahi speaks about. Do not tie your hand to your neck. In other words, an indication of extreme miserliness. وَلَا تَبَسُطَهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ. And do not spread your hands totally open, an indication of extreme generosity. But rather maintain moderation between the two. So in this verse, while the Quran exhorts us to moderation, on a disguised note, the hands and the neck of the Prophet ﷺ was discussed. And let me also remind you, while Allah spoke to him about the latter portion of the ayah, that do not give everything at the cost that you do not have. Let us focus on the first portion of the ayah, because unfortunately, we are those that have withheld everything. Someone made a remark and he said, لا خير في الإسراف. There's no good in extravagance. So another brother replied by saying, La israfa fil khair. May you be reminded there's no extravagance when it comes to good. There's no good in extravagance, point taken. But when it comes to good, there's no extravagance. Abu Bakr gave everything in Tabuk. Is that extravagance? No. Inna al-mubadhirina kanu ikhwana shayateen. But 1 cent in Allah's disobedience, that's extravagance. Allah says those that are extravagant, they are the brothers of the devil. The scholars explain why. Allah gave the devil logic and intellect. He used his logic against Allah. Allah gave these people wealth, they used their wealth against Allah. Hence they share a common thing, they abuse in Allah's faculties against Allah. And then Allah speaks of the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. Just as these cartoons have hurt us, and it caused excruciating pain. Allah says, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we know that you are offended, you are hurt, you are insulted by these derogatory remarks. And in that Allah speaks of his chest and his bosom. But Allah says, take support from performing salah. Then Allah doesn't rest on discussing the chest, but Allah goes to the heart. And Allah speaks of his blessed heart. And what does Allah Ta'ala say? نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ. Allah said, Jibreel came with the Quran. Jibreel came with the Quran and he came on the blessed heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which Ibn Kathir rahmatullah alayhi writes, Unzila ashraful kutubi bi ashrafil lughati ala ashrafil rusuli bi sifarati ashrafil malaika wa kana dhalika fi ashrafi shuhuris sana fakamula min kullil wujuh. Ibn Kathir says, the noblest book was revealed on the noblest human, on the noblest land, via the noblest angel, in the noblest language, in the noblest month. Hence one has to agree it has been perfected from every angle. فَكَمُلَ مِنْ كُلِّ الْوُجُودِ. There's no angle you look at the Quran. What did the Quran say? الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ الْكِتَابَ وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عِوَجًا. All praise belongs to Allah who revealed the Quran on his Nabi and left no flaw in it. قَيِّمًا. Perfect. Perfect. لِيُنذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا. Allah continues. And then Allah speaks of the back of Nabi alayhi salam in the Quran. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ وَوَضَعْنَا عَنْكَ وِزْرَكَ الَّذِي أَنْقَذَ ظَهْرَكَ. O Prophet of Allah, we lighten the burden from you, which was breaking your back, which was breaking your back. What was the burden on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? In many tafsir I read, at times the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do certain things, which was not a sin per se, but given his personality and his high profile position, it was better of him to do something else. When he would be informed that Allah preferred the latter instead of what he did, this would cause him immense pain. This would cause him so much pain that I did not do the preferred thing, but rather I did that which was relatively not so preferred, because he was unaware of it. And this would cause enormous pain to him. Allah removed that burden by giving him blanket forgiveness. What did Allah say? لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. Don't stress, don't depress yourself. You know, person's got, he's got overwhelming debts, and he's got this account and that creditor and this one to me. Someone says, all right, you give me all your liabilities. Don't worry, I'll sort out everything. Allah said, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you don't have sins, but even if you have, or you assume you have, or you will have, everything is forgiven. Everything is forgiven. Jalaluddin Suyuti rahmatullah alayhi makes mention of a riwayat in Khasa'is al-Kubra, on page 29 in the first volume, when prior to the prophethood of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu goes on a journey towards Syria. And on this journey, he sees a dream and a vision. He narrates this dream and this vision to the monk there. The monk congratulates him and tells him, the interpretation of your dream is explicit. In essence, a prophet will emerge from your nation, and you will be amongst his close companions, and you will succeed him after his demise. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu takes this here. He keeps this as a secret. Khasa'is al-Kubra, first volume on page 29. After the prophethood of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he claimed prophethood, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu came to him and said, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you claim to be a prophet. What is the proof of your prophethood? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam looked at him and he said, Abu Bakr, the proof of my prophethood is the dream you seen before I became a prophet. Abu Bakr, the proof of my prophethood is the dream you seen before I became a prophet. He stood up. He was literally elated. He was ecstatic. He hugged Nabi alayhi salam. He kissed him. And Allah's qasam, from that day he never looked back. From that day onwards, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu never ever looked back. What reference to Tazkira Khatamul Anbiya? Tazkira Khatamul Anbiya on page 94. It is written that Allah sent revelation to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wasalam 10 times. Allah sent revelation to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam 10 times. I gave you the reference. Tazkira Khatamul Anbiya on page 94. Allah sent revelation to Ibrahim alayhi salam 48 times in his period of Nabuwat. And Allah sent revelation to Nuh alayhi salam 50 times. Now, let me just digress for a minute and tell you what reference to Sawi. In the footnotes of Jalalain, under the commentary of this ayat, it is written, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ عَبُدُ اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُ. Under the commentary of this ayah, in the footnotes of Jalalain, with reference to Sawi, it is written that Nuh alayhi salam became a prophet at the age of 40. At the age of 40. Then he preached to his people for 950 years. which brings it to 990. At 990, when he was 990 years of age, that is the time Allah sent the floods and destroyed the people. Thereafter, Allah favored him with a life of 60 years. So he passed away at the age of 1050. In this lifespan, or in this period of prophethood of 950 years, Allah Rabbul Izzat sent revelation upon him 50 times. And in Tazkira Khatamul Anbiya, it is written that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in the duration of 23 years of prophethood, received a revelation from Allah 24,000 times. Understand, Adam alayhi salam 10 times, Isa alayhi salam 10 times, Ibrahim alayhi salam 48 times, Nuh alayhi salam 50 times in 950 years. And Allah sent to Nabi alayhi salam 24,000 times in 23 years. At times on one day he got 10 revelations. He enjoyed that closeness with Allah that he told Jibreel, Zurna akthara mimma tazuruna. Jibreel, I have a request. Tell Allah that you must come and visit me even more. I want you, Jibreel, to come even more to me so that I can have more revelation from my Allah. Then the verses were revealed. وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكَ وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكَ لَهُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِينَا وَمَا خَلْفَنَا وَمَا بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ. Say unto them, وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ, say unto him that we only come down by the will of Allah. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I don't come by my own will. In Mishkat Sharif, first volume, there is a hadith that أَنَّ حِبْرًا مِنَ الْيَهُودِ, one great Jewish scholar came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he asked him, which is the noblest piece of land? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I will let you know. When Jibreel came, he said, oh Jibreel, I have a question to ask you and you ask it to my Allah. I want to know which is the noblest piece of land. So Jibreel went to Allah. Now in the footnotes of Mishkat first volume, I think it's Hashiyah number 6, it is written that when Jibreel went before Allah, but at this time Jibreel came as an envoy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So then Allah allowed him to come closer than he used to close because he was representing the request of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when Jibreel returned with the answer, when Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came back with the answer, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he said, Inni danawtu min Allahi dunuwan ma danawtu minhu qattu. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I must inform you on a disguised note that this time when I got close to Allah, I got so close to Allah that never did I enjoy this opportunity. The commentators of hadith elaborate on this portion and they write, وَلَعَلَّ زِيَادَةَ تَقَرُّبِهِ فِي هَذِهِ الْمَرَّةِ لِتَعْظِيمِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَقَدْ يَزِيدُ الْمُحِبُّ فِي إِحْتِرَامِ رَسُولِ الْحَبِيبِ لِأَجْلِ الْحَبِيبِ. I wish you understood this in Arabic. He says, the commentators write, that Jibreel was given additional hospitality because he represented the request of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And many a times a person expresses his love to the messenger of his beloved because of the love that he has for his beloved. Because of the love that he has for his beloved. So Allah sent 24,000 times revelation upon Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then there was one interval where revelation stopped. And that also there is a detailed explanation. According to the riwayat of Bukhari, when revelation stopped, there was one woman in Makkah, she made a nasty remark. She said, it looks like the devil of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam has deserted him. So before I elaborate on this, let me mention something. Whenever any other prophet was offended or insulted, then he defended his position. So when they told him that you are liars, the prophet would stand up and say, Ya qawmi laysa bi dhalala, Ya qawmi laysa bi safaha, I'm not deviated, I'm not astray. But whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was accused, Allah said, "O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you step out of it, I'll defend you." And then Allah defended, "وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى." I swear by the skies and I swear by the stars, my Nabi is not deviated. "Noon وَالْقَلَمِ وَمَا يَسْتُرُونَ." I swear by the pen that wrote the destiny of every human, "مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ." You are not insane. Yasin wal Quran al Hakim. I swear by my book, you are amongst the prophets. Allah said, I will defend you. This woman made the nasty remark that the devil of Muhammad has deserted him. Allah came down in Quran. First, Allah consoled him. And Allah said, we did not desert you, but we withheld revelation to discipline you. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَىٰ. So it wasn't a termination of relation. It was a disciplinary measure, just to put the records correct. Then Allah said, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَىٰ. I'll reward you so much that it will compensate the pain you had in the delay of revelation. Then Allah said, وَمَا تَنَزَّلَتْ بِهِ الشَّيَاطِينَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُمْ وَمَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ إِنَّهُمْ عَنِ السَّمْعِ لَمَعْزُولُونَ. Don't ever say a devil comes with the Quran. It doesn't befit the devil to carry the word of Allah, and it doesn't befit the devil to visit the Nabi of Allah. Let me tell you who the devil visits. هَلْ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ عَلَى مَنْ تَنَزَّلُ الشَّيَاطِينَ تَنَزَّلُ عَلَى كُلِّ أَفَّاكٍ أَثِيمٍ يُلْقُونَ السَّمْعَ وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ كَاذِبُونَ. The devil visits the evil people. I was reading through one ayah, and Allah put this thought in my mind, subhanallah. In Surah Al-Tahrim, Allah speaks about a very unique incident. And Allah reminds us of who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. What had happened amongst the co-wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, amongst the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a bit of bickering, there was a bit of, the usual common between co-wives that would happen. It was quite common amongst them. One riwayat of Muslim Sharif, هُنَّ حَوْلِي يَتْلُبْنَنِي النَّفَقَ. They came with a request to ask for more money. They want more money. Like I was mentioning the other day, our sisters are here, and sisters will be listening on Channel Islam, no offense. But anyway, they say, what? A man thinks he's the boss of the house, only to know he houses the boss. He thinks he's the boss of the house, only to know he's housing the boss. That's what all it is all about. Anyway, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spoke to Hafsa radiallahu anha. And there's different narrations. I don't want to go into the details. I want to bring you to a very sensitive juncture. One riwayat is he told Hafsa about that he won't have honey. One riwayat is he told Hafsa that he won't come to his slave girl Maria Qibtiya radiallahu anha for his human physical need. But he told Hafsa, I am confiding in you. Don't mention this to anyone. This is a secret. And how the Quran says, وَإِذْ أَسَرَّ النَّبِيُّ إِلَىٰ بَعْضِ أَزْوَاجِهِ حَدِيثًا. Brothers, I suffer a dilemma. I have a problem. I cannot translate Quran in the sense that I want you to know it in its original text. Wallah, translated version just doesn't do justice to what Allah is saying. I have become desperate for the message to understand Arabic. Every time I want to convey myself, I just find myself restricted by vocab. I find myself withheld. I don't know how to come across in what my Allah paints and describes. وَإِذْ أَسَرَّ النَّبِيُّ إِلَىٰ بَعْضِ أَزْوَاجِهِ حَدِيثًا. When a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam confided with his partners, and he said, don't mention it to anyone. Woman is woman with respect. She went and divulged the secrets of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Aisha. They both had some personal gain in it, so she divulged it. And amongst the wives, she and Aisha had quite a bit of commonness. So she tells Aisha radiallahu anha, this is the secret, but don't tell anyone. I'm telling you, but don't tell anyone. This is also written in Tafsir al-Uthmani. I read this. Nabi alayhi salam was informed, not through the grapevine, through revelation. He said, oh, I heard about it. Don't worry, through the grapevine. Nabi alayhi salam was not informed through the grapevine, through divine revelation. فَلَمَّا نَبَّأَتْ بِهِ وَأَظْهَرَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ عَرَّفَ بَعْضَهُ وَأَعْرَضَ عَنْ بَعْضٍ. Nabi alayhi salam, very modest, very bashful. Now he realized what happened. So he goes to Hafsa radiallahu anha. And he says, apparently you have divulged some portion of the secret. So, you know, as woman nature is, she becomes a bit sinister about it. She becomes a bit query. So she says, we'll talk about that later. But who told you? Who told you? Now she's trying to fish out information. Did Aisha let it leak? Nabi alayhi salam said, no, don't get Aisha involved here. Nabba'ani. Now she's trying to fish out information. Did Aisha let it leak? Nabi alayhi salam said, no, don't get Aisha involved here. نَبَّأَنِيَ الْعَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. نبأني العليم الخبير. My Allah and your Allah told me about it. So she says, yeah, that's the problem. We can't hide anything from you. Our woman folk also must be wishing they had that contact. Nowadays they have that certain SMSs where they're monitoring you. نبأني العليم الخبير. My Allah told me. Now you listen to this, brothers. My sisters, listen. Undivided attention. Allah then addresses the two wives of Nabi alayhi salam. And Allah says, listen, Aisha and Hafsa. And Allah's qasam, if Allah tells them to listen, you and I have to listen so much more. If Allah can tell it to them, we stand no chance. If this is how clean and clear He can be with Aisha and Hafsa radiallahu anhuma, who are our mothers, who are our leaders, who are our role models, then remember, none of us stand any chance. Allah said, إِن تَتُوبَا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِن تَتُوبَا إِلَى اللَّهِ فَقَدْ صَغَتْ قُلُوبُكُمَا. O Aisha and Hafsa, you better repent now. And you better get your act together now. Saghat means your hearts have turned. Then Allah goes on to say, if you choose not to repent, and you decide to divulge his secrets which causes pain to my Nabi, then let me tell you the backing he has. These are the words of the Quran. I will elaborate what I'm saying. Hear me out, my brother. Allah says, if you choose, وَإِن تَظَاهَرَا عَلَيْهِ. Again, I wish you would know we were talking Arabic here. وَإِن تَظَاهَرَا عَلَيْهِ. If you decide to help one another against him, then may you be politely reminded. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ مَوْلَاهُ وَجِبْرِيلُ وَصَالِحُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ بَعْدَ ذَٰلِكَ ظَهِيرٌ. If you decide to cause that pain to him, then may you be politely reminded he is not alone. Allah is his guardian. Jibreel is his protector. The pious believers support him, and the malaika are behind him. Allah says, Allah is his guardian. Jibreel is his protector. And then Allah says, وَصَالِحُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and the pious believers. Now you go into the commentary of this ayah. Under the description of the pious believers, who is referred to? In all the tafasir, it is written that it refers to the general Muslims because صَالِحُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, but the most deserving are, the first that will be on his side is Abu Bakr and Umar. So Aisha is reminded, radiallahu anha, if you have a tiff with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember Abu Bakr is not on your side, he's on the side of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Hafsa radiallahu anha is reminded, if you have a difference with your Nabi, remember Umar Farooq doesn't stand as your father, he stands as a faithful ummati of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah comes down in full force. This is what he said. Then Allah goes on. Asa Rabbuhu. Allah is not yet over. Allahu Akbar. Brothers, and then you put a blade on the sunnah of this Nabi, and you shave your beard of this Nabi. I don't know how to cry. Wallah, brothers, I don't know what to say. My heart cries non-stop when I see youngsters putting a blade on this beard. Old, aged man, ready to go in his cover, but still violently puts a blade on that beard. My brother, you suffer a complex in reflecting his image. Wallah, when I hear about youngsters that grow their beards, Allah alone knows what joy. When I was in California now, as I entered into the masjid, one young American Muslim came to me running. Shaykh, salamu alaykum. I said, wa alaykum as-salam. You remember me, Shaykh? I said, no. He said, the last time you came here, I said in your talk, you spoke about the beard. From that day, I've never touched my beard. He said, but Shaykh, you must come home. My mother has been making dua for you from that day till today. From that day till today, I implore every brother and I beg of every sister, mutually encourage your husband and children to reflect the image of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah then comes down in full force and Allah says, عَسَى رَبُّهُ إِن طَلَّقَكُنَّ أَن يُبْدِلَهُ أَزْوَاجًا خَيْرًا مِنْكُنَّ مُسْلِمَاتٍ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ قَانِتَاتٍ تَائِبَاتٍ عَابِدَاتٍ سَائِحَاتٍ ثَيِّبَاتٍ وَأَبْكَارًا. Allah says, listen, don't be complacent that you are his Nabi and you are his wife and your position is secured. Remember, if he chooses to divorce you, I'll substitute you with better woman. I will substitute you with better woman. Allah says this to the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the commentators explore, how can there be any woman better than the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? But I read this in many tafaseer. The answer of this is simple, that they are noble because they are in your wedlock. As soon as they are divorced, that honor is snatched away from them. So their nobility lies because they are your partners. Their nobility lies because they are your partners. There were five kuffar that used to mock at Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah speaks about it in this verse. Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'in. Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'in. Alladhina yaj'aluna ma'allahi ilahan akhar. O Nabi of Allah, we will personally deal with anyone and everyone who dares mock you once. Who were these five kuffar? Walid ibn Mughira, As ibn Wa'il, Aswad ibn Abdul Muttalib, Aswad ibn Yaghuth, and Harith ibn Qais. These were five kuffar who mocked at Nabi alayhi salam. One, Allah caused him to become blind. One, Allah caused a thorn to prick him. It became poisonous and it claimed his life. Walid ibn Mughira, what a foolish man. He comes in the company of Nabi alayhi salam. He hears about hellfire. He becomes afraid. He says, I want to accept Islam. He meets a friend of his. His friend says, no. I'll sort out that punishment. You pay me monthly. You pay me monthly and I'll avert all the punishment. Tafsir Uthmani, I'll give you reference now. I will sort out all your punishments. You give me, you pay me monthly, I'll fix you up that side. So he says, if it's on, I'll pay you. So he starts paying. One month he pays. Second month he pays. Then he says, hey, you know what? My money is going, but I got no deposit slip here. I got no transfer proof here. أَفَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي تَوَلَّى وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى. He gives little and then he withdraws. These five kuffar, Allah destroyed them. The riwayat of Ibn Kathir, Nabi alayhi salam is performing salah. Abu Jahl made the nasty remark and he said, Wallati wal Uzza, la in ra'aytuhu yusalli la ata'anna ala raqabatihi wa la a'firanna wajhahu fit turab. I swear by Lat and Uzza, if I see this Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam making sajda again, I will put my foot on his neck and I will hurt him. The next time the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is performing salah, so his companions provoke him. They say, there's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, go for it. So he advances with pride and arrogance. As he comes towards Nabi alayhi wasallam, he makes a sudden halt. And then, yankusu ala aqibayhi wa yattaqi bi yadayhi, the riwayat of Ibn Kathir. He starts retreating and he's pushing something back. So people told him, what happened? You were talking big, you wanted to... He said, "Inna baini wa bainahu khandaqan min nar." As I got close, I seen a trench of fire, and I seen huge, frightening creatures, and they were advancing towards me. So I started withdrawing and retreating. Nabi alayhi salam said, "Law dana minni, lakhtatafathu al-malaikatu udwan." If he had to come 1 inch closer, the angels would have severed his body into pieces. And one riwayat, لَوْ فَعَلَ لَأَخَذَتْهُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ عِيَانًا. The angels would have gripped him there and there. They would have chopped his body into bits and pieces. Allah revealed the verses. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى عَبْدًا إِذَا صَلَّى أَرَأَيْتَ إِنْ كَانَ عَلَى الْهُدَى. And then with arrogance, what he says, I will call my men. Allah says, فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيًا سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيًا. Tell him to call his men. We are unleashing the angels of hellfire. You know what is Allah's treasures? When I was in America, I was reading every day about this Wilma and Katrina and Rita and Wilma, whatever, all these violent winds. When Allah decided, the riwayat of Ibn Kathir, I read it myself. When Allah decided to destroy the nation of Ad, Allah said, unleash my winds. The Malaika said, how much? Can we unleash it equivalent to the nostrils of a cow? Allah said, if you unleash it so much, it will destroy the whole universe. Allah, how much? Allah said, a very, very minute amount. What did that minute wind of the treasures of my Allah do? سَخَّرَهَا عَلَيْهِمْ سَبْعَ لَيَالٍ وَثَمَانِيَةَ أَيَّامٍ 7 nights, 8 days. حُسُومًا, Allah says, we smash them to smatherings. صَرْصَرٍ عَاتِيَةً تَنْزِعُ النَّاسِ, it uplifted people, it uprooted people. One treasure of Allah, one treasure. Allah said, tell him to call, سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةِ, we are unleashing the angels. How many are they? 19, they are 19 angels in charge. The riwayat of Bukhari, Urwa radiallahu anhu says, I asked As ibn Wa'il, I asked Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu, أخبرني بأشد شيء, أخبرني بأشد شيء صنعه المشركون برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Inform me of the most painful thing that the disbelievers ever did to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Hazrat Amr radiallahu anhu said, I remember one incident. One day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was performing salah, and then إذ أقبل عليه عقبة ابن أبي معيط, عقبة ابن أبي معيط came and he took a cloth and he tied it around the neck of Nabi alayhi salam. خنقه خنقا شديدا, and then he started throttling the blessed neck of Nabi alayhi salam. He started choking the neck of Nabi alayhi salam. Abu Bakr seen this and he came, he advanced, دفعه, he pushed a few, he moved a few, he comforted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, woe be to you, Allah takes the qasam of this body in the Quran, and you dare do this to my Nabi. Allah spoke of his standing, إِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ حِينَ تَقُومُ, I'm watching you when you're standing. وَتَقَلُّبَكَ فِي السَّاجِدِينَ, I'm watching you when you're turning. You know, a mother, she's watching her child, she's every minute, and then she's in the kitchen, then she's got that something to control and give a signal the child is crying. My mother, you haven't watched your child, how much my Nabi has watched, how Allah has watched his Nabi. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that devoted companion of Nabi alayhi salam, Allahu Akbar, I was just reading one incident now. When Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam went for hijrat, and Abu Bakr came and gave him the conveyance and took whatever he owned. You know, today we think we have mature children. Look at children today. Subhanallah. Asma radiallahu anha is at home. Abu Bakr is gone in hijrat. Look at the maturity of this young girl. And look at the test that came upon Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. When they realized the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was gone, obviously the first target to go is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Next in charge is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So they come to the house of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. First, before this, let me mention, when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is gone for hijrat, he leaves behind nothing. So they come to the house of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. First, before this, let me mention, when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is gone for hijrat, he leaves behind nothing. His father, Abu Quhafa, who was blind and was 83 of age, he comes home. He comes to his granddaughter. He says, Asma, your father is gone with his friend, because the old man wasn't a Muslim at that time. Has your father left behind any money? He uses the word khair, which has a dual meaning, which is ambiguous. It means goodness and it means wealth. Now look at the maturity of this girl. She understands the loyalty to her father and the loyalty to Nabi alayhi salam, and she understands the obligation to her grandfather. One side, I'm a Muslim and this is what my Allah wants. My father, my grandfather is a non-Muslim, he cannot understand. I've got to play a matured role here. I ask if my sister today can play that mature role when she's asked to give a word on media. Even if we have our differences, but at least we can show a united front. At least we can not expose our dirty linen to public. At least we can come across in a dignified way and save the honor of the Muslim Ummah. Look at the maturity of this girl. I marvel and marvel. She brings her grandfather in the house. Now we think our sisters are psychologists and what this therapy and that therapy, and they are smart and they clued and they skilled and they competent. I don't know what you want to call this here, but listen what she did. Asma radiallahu anha said, come, oh my grandfather. She takes little small pebbles and she stuffs it into some money bags. And then she brings the grandfather and she makes him take his hand and gently feel these packets. He feels it. He was blind. He feels it. Obviously, he was not a Muslim, so he wanted to know if there was any monetary in cash. He could not understand barakat. He could not understand Nabi alayhi salam because he was not a Muslim. But look at the maturity of this girl. Look at the maturity of this girl. She says, I took the hand of my grandfather. I made him feel everything. He was satisfied. He said, Taraka khayran kathira. I'm happy your father has left behind a lot of money. Asma radiallahu anha said, Wallahi ma taraka lana shay. I swear by Allah, my father did not leave behind one dirham. Abu Quhafa comes, he goes. Then Abu Jahl comes home. Abu Jahl says, where's your father? One side she's missing her father. Her grandfather she has to do up with. Then the tantrums of Abu Jahl. But she grew up in the lap of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. She grew up in the house of Nabi alayhi salam. The riwayat of Bukhari, Aisha radiallahu anha said that every day, a day would not pass but that Nabi alayhi salam would visit our house. A day would not pass but that Nabi alayhi salam would come home. So the contact between Nabi alayhi salam and Abu Bakr was every minute. So she asked Asma, where is your father? So Asma radiallahu anha says, I don't know. This nasty, evil, wretched man slaps Asma radiallahu anha. Oh, the Asma of today, while you arrogantly, emphatically unveil your hair and expose your beauty and disgrace the deen of Allah and humiliate the name that you have, remember what Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr, did to preserve this deen. She takes the slap of Abu Jahl. The riwayat says her earring falls out. She picks it up. She cries. Her grandfather came, his tantrums. Then Abu Jahl comes. Her father is out. Abu Bakr was fully conscious that when I'm going to leave, these situations will come on my house. But everything was accepted in the love of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Everything was part of the spirit of Nabi alayhi salam. And that is why one person came to Huzaifa radiallahu anhu. And he said, Huzaifa radiallahu anhu, رَأَيْتُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَسَحِبْتُمُوهُ. You people seen Nabi alayhi salam literally with your eye? And you stayed with Nabi alayhi salam? He said, yes, we stayed with him. So he said, you're so lucky. What did you people do? He said, Wallahi laqad kunna najtahid. We stood by his side. We defended him. We supported him. So this person said, Wallahi law ra'aynahu. If we had to see the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma taraknahu yamshi ala al-ard. Wala hamalnahu ala a'naqina. We wouldn't allow him to walk on this earth. We would have carried him on our shoulders. So Huzaifa said, bye, stop there and there. Easier said than done. Wallah, Allah has been kind. Allah has sent us in this era. My brother, as much as I, my sister, as much as you, want to anticipate that we were born in that era. I'm afraid the price that it demanded to be faithful at that time, neither I have it nor you have it. You know what Huzaifa radiallahu anhu told him? He said, bye, stop making these claims. We would have carried Nabi alayhi salam on our shoulders and we would have done this and that. Let me tell you one story and it will sum it up all. If you had to only be present on the day of Khandaq, I give you one story. Huzaifa radiallahu anhu is telling it to this non-Sahabi. You say, you would have done this. Come, I tell you what we did and what it demanded. Easier said than done. Easier said than done. Come, I tell you of Khandaq. You know what was Khandaq? إِذْ جَاءُوكُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ. Allah says, when the armies came from the top, from the bottom, from the rear, from the front, وَبَلَغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ الْحَنَاجِرِ, and the hearts reached the throats. وَتَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَ, and it became so challenging that the true colors of the hypocrites were exposed because they were not trusting Allah. They were running on the strength of spoils of war. But now here it was becoming a ferocious battle. So their colors got exposed. The faithful from the unloyal were exposed. There was clear differentiation. And then what did Allah say? وَتَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَ. And the hypocrites started harboring thoughts about Allah. Where's the help of Allah? Where's the promises of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? And what did Allah say? هُنَالِكَ بْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. هُنَالِكَ بْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. At this juncture, the believers were shaken and they were tested. It was so critical that the munafiqeen came and said, إِنَّ بُيُوتَنَا عَوْرًا وَمَا هِيَ بِعَوْرًا إِن يُرِيدُونَ إِلَّا فِرَارًا. They said, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know what? Our homes are unprotected and they are exposed and we fear that someone will attack it. Allah says it was protected. The excuse of unprotected was a pretext. They just wanted to run. They just wanted to flee. The munafiqeen deserted. This was the time. Huzaifa radiallahu anhu said, at this moment the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, مَنْ يَذْهَبُ فَيَأْتِينَا بِخَبْرِهِمْ جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ رَفِيقِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Who will stand up and go and get some information from the enemies so that we can monitor their movements, and Allah will make him my closest friend on the day of Qiyamah. What a privilege. Not one Sahabi stood up. And you saying you would have carried him on your shoulders. You would have carried him on your shoulders. Ask me, my brother, Huzaifa radiallahu anhu is saying, Hatta nada al-thaniya. He repeated his announcement. Man yadhhab fayatina bi khabrihim ja'alahu Allahu rafiqi yawm al-qiyamah. Who will stand up and go and inform us about the movements of the kuffar? Allah will make him my companion. Nobody stood up. The Prophet ﷺ said it for the third time. Why? Not because they did not want to. Ma bihim min al-jur. Huzaifa radiallahu anhu said, the hunger was so severe. The cold was so extreme. We were clinging to the ground. We could barely feel the limbs of our body. And then he told me, Ya Huzaifa, idhab. Huzaifa, now I'm explicitly telling you, stand up and go. I had no choice in the matter. We stood by his side at that moment. For us brothers, we take solace from one hadith. Bidayah wa Nihaya, 6th volume, page 339. There is a sahabi by the name of Ma'an ibn Adi radiallahu anhu. At the critical death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at the crucial juncture, every man wanted that he had died before so that he doesn't face this painful moment. But there was a sahabi by the name of Ma'an ibn Adi, as I mentioned in Bidayah wa Nihaya, 6th volume on page 339. He said, لَكِنِّي وَاللَّهِ مَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَمُوتَ قَبْلَهُ لِأُصَدِّقَهُ مَيِّتًا كَمَا صَدَّقْتُهُ حَيًّا. I want to live after him. And Allah has given you and I that privilege. Which was the passion of Ma'an ibn Adi radiallahu anhu amongst the galaxy of Sahaba. What was his passion? He said, I want to live after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam so that I can testify his prophethood after his demise, just as I testified it while he was alive. So I can only do that if I live beyond him. So as I pointed to him and I said, Allah's Qasam, this is the Nabi of Allah. I will come to his grave and I will say, Allah's Qasam, my Nabi is resting in this grave. And hence I quoted before you the riwayat of Madarij al-Nubuwa. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man zara qabri wajabat lahu shafa'ati. The one who visits my grave, my intercession becomes compulsory for him. My intercession becomes compulsory for him. And in one riwayat he said, وَمَنْ زَارَنِي بَعْدَ مَمَاتِي فَكَأَنَّمَا زَارَنِي فِي حَيَاتِي. And the one who visits my grave after my death, it is as if he visited me while I was alive. There are certain etiquettes when we visit the grave of Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ جَاءُوكَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا اللَّهَ واستغفر لهم الرسول لوجدوا الله توابا رحيما. Allah speaks about coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But really respected brothers, listeners, mothers and sisters, all this love that we have for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, until and unless it is not coupled with compliance, with obedience, with devotion, then I'm afraid Abu Talib's incident is a very, very big example in this regard. Abu Talib loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his family members the most. He defended the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the most. Today you and I are standing up in his defense, and rightfully so. But let's ask him what he wants. He told us in the occasion of Abu Talib, he needed Abu Talib's kalima more than his support. As much as he enjoyed the support, make no mistake, don't get me wrong, he loved Abu Talib. He loved Abu Talib. So what happened? He supported Abu Talib supported the cause of Nabi alayhi salam. He comforted Nabi alayhi salam. The kuffar came to Abu Talib and they said, now tell your nephew to stop it. So he came to Nabi alayhi salam. He said, Inna qawmaka ja'uni wa qalu li kada wa kada fa abqi alayya wa ala nafsik wa la tuhammilni min al amri ma la taqata li bihamliha. Listen, my nephew, your nation have come and they said, enough is enough. Why don't you call it a day now? Stop your mission. He said, my uncle, if you want to stop your protection, you are entitled to. لَوْ وُضِعَ الشَّمْسُ فِي يَمِينِي وَالْقَمَرُ فِي يَسَارِي. Let me give you the last. Let me give you the worst case scenario. They put in difficulties, tell them to intensify it. Tell them to multiply it. In a simple phrase, tell them to put the sun in my hand. Or give me comforts. As they tempted him with options, you and I will fall for those options. إن كنت إنما تريد بما جئت من هذا الأمر مالا جمعنا لك من أموالنا حتى تكون أغنى قريش مالا إن كنت تريد به شرفا سودناك عليك إن كنت تريد به ملكا ملكناك عليك إن كان إنما بك الباء فاختر أي نساء قريش شئت فلنزوجك عشرا. You decide what you want, O Muhammad. You want women, we give you the best. You want authority, we make you our ruler. You want wealth, we make you the wealthiest. You want position, we afford it to you. Nabi alayhi salam said, put the sun in my right hand, the moon in my left hand. I will never forsake the deen of Allah. Abu Talib said, I understood my nephew, I'll never desert you. I will never desert you. He came to Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi alayhi salam came to him in the throes of death. Said, Abu Talib, you did so much for me. Just whisper the kalima in my ears and leave the rest to me. Abu Talib, whisper the kalima in my ears and leave the rest to me. So he said, Wallahi lawla an tu'ayyirani Quraishun yaquluna ma hamalahu illa jaza'ul maut la aqrartu biha aynayk lima ara min shiddati wajdik wa nasihatik. Really, my nephew, if it wasn't for the fear of the insults of my fellow companions after my death, that they will say, Abu Talib deserted us at the moment of death, I would have said it and I would have brought comfort to your eyes. I know the passion you have. Then he said, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ بِأَنَّ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ مِّنْ خَيْرِ أَدْيَانِ الْبَرِيَّةِ دِينَ وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ بِأَنَّ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ مِّنْ خَيْرِ أَدْيَانِ الْبَرِيَّةِ دِينَ لَوْلَا الْمَلَامَ أو حذار مسبة لوجدتني سمحا بذلك مبينا. Wallah, I know my nephew, your religion is the true religion. If it wasn't for the fear of insults and criticisms, I would have embraced it before others. But I'm afraid, ولكن سأموت على ملة الأشياخ. I will take my last breath on the faith of my forefathers. Brothers, this is a very, very critical thing. We don't speak about it. Mufassireen have written, we mustn't discuss this unnecessarily. We restrict ourselves to the text of the Quran. What I'm saying is, he loved Nabi alayhi salam. He loved Nabi alayhi salam. The riwayat of Bukhari, someone told Nabi alayhi salam, Ma aghnayta an ammi. Your uncle did for you so much, but you didn't benefit him in any way. Nabi alayhi salam said, No. Lawla ana lakana fi darki al asfali min al nar. I did a lot for him. Because of me, he suffers the least punishment in hell. If it wasn't me, he would have suffered the worst in hell. لَوْلَا أَنَا لَكَانَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. So my point to you is, my brothers and sisters and listeners, is that really the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants our compliance. He wants that we revive his life. I leave you with one, two things. He has asked us, there are certain things the Prophet ﷺ has asked us. You know, a person who has been kind to you, then you actually wait for him to ask you for a favor. You wait for him because he's done you so much good. You say, Allah, I hope this man can ask me to do me a favor because I want to give him back something. He has asked us for one thing. He said, سَلُوا اللَّهَ لِي الْوَسِيلَةَ سَلُوا اللَّهَ لِي الْوَسِيلَةَ. I'm asking you, when the adhan is on, don't speak. And when the adhan is completed, make this dua. Allahumma rabba hadhihi ad-da'wati at-tamma was-salati al-qa'ima. Because in this dua, you are asking Allah something from me. And Allah has promised it. And I know Allah will give it. But I just want my ummatis to reaffirm the request. You know, you tell someone, you meet him, he knows about it, but in a style, just put in a word. He knows about it, but just, you know, bring it in the topic and everything, just to remind him about it. Yeah, Ibrahim was telling me about the car and that also. So you just blend the topic in. Nabi alayhi salam said, Allah is going to give me that. What is it? عَسَىٰ أَن يَبَعَثَكَ رَبُّكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. The praised platform. What is the praised platform? The supreme intercession. What is the supreme intercession? Allah speaks about tahajjud. Let me just speak about this and I will end. Allah speaks about tahajjud. Prior to the obligation of 5 daily salah, tahajjud was compulsory. Then the obligation of 5 daily salah came, and then tahajjud, the obligation of tahajjud was lifted from the ummah, but there is debate if it was lifted from Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or not. However, whether it was lifted or not, there is no doubt that he never missed it. Whether he never opted for concessions, he never opted. He took the most difficult thing upon himself and he provided concessions to others. He provided concessions to others. Others, he made things easy. For himself, he always. When it came to sacrifice, he put his family on first. He put his family on first. So, عَسَىٰ أَن يَبْعَثَكَ رَبُّكَ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا. What happened here? The Quran says, فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكَ. Very beautifully explained by the commentators. Allah says, perform tahajjud, this is additional for you. This is extra for you. The scholars debate this word, نَافِلَةً لَكَ. This is extra for everyone. Why does Allah make reference that is extra for Nabi alayhi salam? The beautiful answer provided is that when you and I read any nafal salah or perform any nafal prayer, be it tahajjud or anything else, it is indeed additional and extra, but it serves as an atonement and compensation for our mistakes. So it might be extra technically, but in reality it's just patching up. It's just like a person gets a bonus, so someone says, oh, you're happy now? You got extra. He says, no, but not extra. I must pay more for the car now. It's just I must pay. This month I'll pay so much more. I came home with an extra check, but that doesn't mean I got more money. I'm owing you, so I'll be just paying more. When Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam performed any nafl, there was no question of compensation because there was no mistakes. So every optional act in his condition was the elevation of status. Was the elevation. Then Allah told him, and I tie it up with this request, he has asked us, one, two requests. The Prophet ﷺ's request, it's my heart's desire that Yaseen be in the heart of every ummati. One simple request he has asked us. Imagine the Prophet of Allah said, this is my desire. And then he has also told us of his dislikes. It is my desire to burn your house if you perform salah in your house. فَأُحَرِّقَ عَلَيْهِمْ بُيُوتَهُمْ. I read this hadith and I cry. An embodiment of compassion, a perfect human of softness, gentleness. And for him to desire to burn the house of someone, your crime must be grave for a man like him to desire that. Your crime must be enormous for a kind man like this here. Allah said, perform tahajjud and I will give you that supreme intercession. I will give you that lofty position. What is that lofty position? That on the day of Qiyamah, when humanity will converge and congregate, and then Allah's anger will be at its peak, no human will dare come close to Allah. So they will come to Ibrahim alayhi salam and say, Ibrahim, we have a request. Ibrahim alayhi salam will say, I spoke a lie by mistake. I don't have the courage. Go to Musa alayhi salam. They'll go to Musa alayhi salam. He will say, by the record, I hit one person unintentionally. That man died. This is not my privilege. But why don't you try your luck with Isa? Maybe you win there. They'll come to Isa alayhi salam. Isa alayhi salam will say, me and my mother were the contentious figures. People say, Jesus is God. So people ascribe partners to me. Really, I don't stand a chance. But you know what? Try your luck with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They'll come to Nabi alayhi salam, the entire creation. In humility, he will say, come to me today. This is exclusive to me. This is wasila. This is maqamam mahmood. Scholars write, Allah could have also done that the entire creation go direct to Nabi alayhi salam. But then you wouldn't have appreciated him. You know, you go to a shop, you pick up an article, they say 20 rand, you say, oh, too expensive. Then you tour 10 shops and you come back. And then you realize this man was cheap. Someone started from 30, someone started from 40. Allah will direct the creation to every Nabi. Remember what Musa Kalimullah couldn't do for you. What Ibrahim Khalilullah declined. What Isa Ruhullah excused himself from what Adam Safiullah said, my hands are down. That is what Muhammad SAW said, come and I will do it for you. So really, my respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, what is expected from us is compliance. What is expected from us is diligence. That is what the Prophet ﷺ said, and I can say much more. We make dua to the Almighty Allah that He give us the tawfiq and the ability that in this hostile environment we revive His sunnah. What did He say? Al-qailuna yawma'idhim bil-kitabi was-sunnah. Al-qailuna yawma'idhim bil-kitabi was-sunnah. Kas-sabiqin al-awwalin min al-muhajirin wal-ansar. They are two people who enjoy the great privileges. One who stood by my side on the early hours. لا يستوي منكم من أنفق من قبل الفتح وقاتل. Those who fought on my side before the conquest of Makkah, they, and likewise those who will stand by my side in the latter part, those who will come and stand by my side in the latter, those that will stand and preserve my teachings before Qiyamah will enjoy the same reward of the Muhajirin and the Ansar in the early hours. Those who stood by Nabi alayhi salam, Sahaba were those devoted people. Sahaba were those devoted people. Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Abdi Rabbihi radiyallahu anhu. After the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Tanzimul Ashtad, the whole riwayat comes, which is a commentary of Mishkat. He came to the Kaaba and he said, Oh Allah, as long as your Nabi was alive, I seen him. Now that your Nabi is gone, what am I going to do with these eyes? Allah, I want that the last I seen was your Nabi. So I ask you, make me blind on the spot. فَكُفَّ بَصَرُهُ. And then Allah Ta'ala took his gaze away so that his last sight be that of Nabi alayhi salam. We ask the ummati of today not to become blind, but we do ask them to become blind from haram. We ask every brother and every sister to become blind from every haram, to become deaf from every act of haram. May Allah Ta'ala save us from every vice. Make it easy for this ummah in these trying moments. And take this ummah and once again restore its glory. May Allah give us the ability that we reflect the noble life and the image of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.